afternoon, everybody. I will begin with some remarks just to justify the title of my paper, Neurotheology and Vedanta. Maybe some of you may be not so much conversant with the very concept of neurotheology. That's why I have to say some words about it. It means it takes sense in the context of contemporary paradigm that is especially prevalent nowadays in scientific circles, especially among social science researchers or biologists. That paradigm, in a way, it's quite simple. It's a materialistic one. It considers origin as such, as a phenomenon basically pathological, and at the same time something outdated that could not survive very long in our present time. Broadly speaking, it's on the line of Freud's very famous judgment about religion as a form of neurosis at the scale of humanity itself. So, before raising the question of the conditions for mutual understanding of religions in the context of this paradigm, it's urgent to raise the question of the validity, the perennial validity of the phenomenon of religion as such. And here comes the notion of neurotheology, which I'm going to explain just in 2 minutes. Because, of course, it will not be very easy to ask the question on a very, very large scale, I choose the Vedanta, which is both a philosophy and a religion at the same time, as a touchstone to begin to understand what it's all about. So, I would like to start with a quotation from a book called Phantoms in the Brain, a book by Villayalur Ramachandran, a California-based neurologist, definitely one of the most prominent ones of our time. The text is at the beginning of chapter 12, and it runs like this. The first half of the next century, science will confront its greatest challenge in trying to answer a question that has been steeped in mysticism and metaphysics for millennia. What's the nature of the self? As someone who was born in India and raised in the Hindu tradition, I was taught that the concept of the self, the I within one, that is aloof from the universe and engages in a lofty inspection of the world around, that's around me, is an illusion, a veil called Maya. The search for enlightenment, I was told, consists of lifting this veil and realizing that you are really one with the cosmos. Ironically, after extensive training in Western medicine and more than 15 years of research on neurological patients and visual illusion, I've come to realize that there is much truth to this central mystery. That notion of a single united self inhabiting the brain may indeed be an illusion. For me, the central mystery of the universe is this one. Why do we have two descriptions in terms of He says, excuse me, the first person perspective in terms of I'm seeing something red first, and then in the third person perspective in terms of he says he's seeing something red whenever certain neural paths in his brain are confronted with 600,000 nanometer long light waves. Dissolve his barrier, says the Indian mystics and sages, and you will see that the separation between self and non-self is an illusion, that you are really one with the cosmos. Let us recall that this formula of Ramachandra constitute a kind of digest of the Vedanta, especially of the non-dualistic school of Shankara as expressed in Upanishadic formulas like aham brahmasmi, I am Brahman, the absolute, or tat phamasi, you are that, that is always Brahman. That said, it is clear that the program envisaged by Ramachandra is a huge one, to the point of being perhaps never fully achievable. However, various avenues of research, which were opened in recent past, seek to bridge, without necessarily cultivating such high ambitions, seek to bridge the gap between two areas that many consider as completely foreign to one another, mystical experience on the one side and brain science on the other side. That was the question of the paradigm I was speaking of. I mean, in the frame of the paradigm of contemporary biology, all phenomena within the brain, including the religious one, can be explained in terms of neurological connection between neurons. So, one of the most original among these avenues is now known by the name of neurotheology. The term was coined by two American researchers, D'Aquila and Newberg, and appear for the first time in a book with a revealing title, Why God Won't Go Away, in 1906. This title is indeed revealing insofar that it reflects the attitude essentially defensive at the beginning of its authors. It was for them to show, basing on the very data of neurology, that religious experience is original. That is, in the same way as, for example, perceptual or emotional experience. It won't come to anybody to consider perceptual or emotional experience as something completely really non-existing, but it does come to the mind of many people today to consider, of course, religious idea in general as something completely imagined. So since that time, a lot of researchers have joined them, all trying in some way or another to clear out the puzzling interference of mental pathology and encounter with the holy. Something about that paradigm itself. So someone, in the first half of the 20th century, the view originated that a certain type, at least, of religiosity was tightly associated with what's called in medical terms temporal lobe epilepsy. This kind of trouble, a comparatively minor form of epilepsy, starts with partial seizures involving voices, music, smells, tastes, forgotten memories, and usually, unusually intense feelings. Very soon, some neurologists framed the hypothesis that the limbic structure, special structure called the limbic system of the brain, it's a structure situated in the proximity of the temporal lobe, and including, well, I pass what it includes, that plays a central role in such seizures. These crises are being described as involving the loss of a sense of self as distinct from the environment, and as inducing a tendency to see heightened significance in ordinary situation. In this context, some psychiatrists describe the so-called Gishwin syndrome, a personality type characterized by hypermoralism, deepened affects, humorlessness, interpersonal viscosity, that's a tendency to cling to others in a way that may damage relationships. Hypergraphia, altered sexuality, aggressive irritability, and so on. In chapter 8 of his book, quoted above, Dr. Ramachandran gives a quite vivid description of the typical behavior of such passions. He came across a patient, a certain Paul, I quote, who was a textbook case of this so-called temporal lobe syndrome. He was a 32 years old epileptic who obsessively talked and wrote about religious subjects. He told Ramachandran that during his epileptic seizures, he felt a rapturous oneness with the Creator that carried over into the rest of his life. When Ramachandran asked him if he did believe in God, he just replied with a puzzled expression, "But what else is there? What else is there?" Some specialists, speculating on the basis of such clinical observation, ventured to frame the hypothesis that many great religious figures of the past, for instance, the Apostle Paul, Muhammad, the prophet of Islam, or the Hindu mystics of the 19th century, Ramakrishna, for instance, may have actually displayed symptoms of temporal lobe epilepsy. Well, unfortunately, because lack of time, have to renounce to describe in details the results of the inquiries by those neurophilologists. There were the historical founders, Daquilly and Newberg, and later on, their experiences were taken up again on a more systematic and wide basis by Canadian researchers based in Montreal. And give you a very simplified sketch of their results. Their results were globally positive ones. That means they found regularly some correlation between the brain, the condition of the brain of those people, essentially first Buddhist monks, then Christian nuns, especially Carmelite nuns at Montreal. So it was possible to make a sort of to point out some sort of bilateral correspondence between the internal impression, the way those people describe their experiences, both at the moment of the experience itself and immediately after coming out of it, and On the other side, the profile, I mean, of brain states, it's a bit technical. And unfortunately, I have no time to explicit what kinds of what means of observation were used by these people. But we can retain the positive action of the notion of correspondence. So sort in the hide of those researchers, they believed at least that they had found out a real relationship that could be repeated by anybody between some sort of very profound, very intimate religious, mystical experiences and some very very easily described profiles in the state of brain. So now I come back and with that I come back to Ramat Chandra's Advaita formulas as quoted in the beginning. To proceed beyond the duality of first and third person perspective, to become one with the cosmos. So, could we find any verification on confirmation of them in the birth and rise of neurotheology, which is expanding at the present time? I would answer, not really. As these studies, to my knowledge, have been developed during the 20 last years, essentially, as I said, with reference to Christian spirituality and to Buddhism. I say to my knowledge, because it's quite possible, after all, that some people in India or elsewhere might have tried in the recent past to apply to Vedanta spirituality the very methods and concepts of neurotheology. Let me recall in this context, for instance, the pioneering work of the French doctor Thérèse Bos, who as early as 1950, yes, more than 60 years ago, had started the scientific investigation of yogic meditation using those electroencephalographic techniques that were available at that time. Needless to say that the prison techniques are much more sophisticated than just in lights. Nevertheless, some difficulties may be kept. Some difficulties may arise in as much as we keep in mind the specificities of the Vedanta, especially in its more radical version, the so-called Advaita Vedanta or non-dualistic Vedanta, as illustrated, for instance, by Shankara and his disciples. Actually, from the point of view of that school, nothing short of total dissolution of the subject into the supreme reality or Brahman can be recognized as true meditation. As long as Brahman remains wrapped, in some theistic garb. For instance, is being, in Indian terms, is being apprehended in a devotional style, as Shiva or as Vishnu. So as long as this happens, we have to do with an inferior form of religious behavior called bhakti, or love, let us say, loving participation. Hence, both the difficulty and special interest of applying to grammatical spirituality the methods and concepts of neurophilology, as recently developed with reference to Christianity. What kind of discoveries is awaiting us in this field. Shall we come across striking similarities at the divisional, in Pacti, level or not? And what about the ultimate transpersonal level? Will it have also its neurophysiological signature? And will it be perhaps possible to find, so to say, in retrospection, some equivalent of it in Christian or Islamic or Jewish subjects, even if it is not recognized as such in the relevant theology? Perhaps with the exception of what is called fana in Sufi mysticism, but it's another question. So anyway, what will be the consequences at the politic level? I mean, if in some way or another we would find, not at the level of speculation, but at the level of scientific, repeatable verification, that there is a total convergence of these experiences. Of course, there are a lot of possible objections. The main objection, perhaps, would be to say there is some hypothesis that is not being criticized at that level. Are we sure, after all, that all those experiences can be traced along a continuous scale, a continuous line of development? Maybe there are some lines that are quite separated from one another from the beginning. I do think that it's a question that will be, of course, the object of intense reflection and experimentation in the near future, because, of course, I guess it's a very, very complex one. So, just to finish, I believe, maybe I am quite wrong, I believe that the discovery of similarities, some of them perhaps completely unexpected, is going to widely outweigh the possible confirmation of differences. Neurotheology is perhaps, just an element of a new, all-encompassing scientific frame of reference that may significantly contribute to the development of a planetary type of consciousness, in the context of which historical religions may learn to look at one another no more as rivals, but somehow as sisters helping each other to approach a truth too lofty to remain the monopoly of any church whatsoever.